Light is the connection between us and the universe. Through light, we can experience distant stars and look back at the beginning of existence itself. But what is light?
We'll come back to that, GW.
In a nutshell, light is the smallest quantity of energy that can be transported, a photon. An elementary particle without a real size that can't be split, only created or destroyed. Light also has a wave-particle duality, being kind.
Slow down. There's so much here that he just said, which would require, you know, degrees, a PhD's worth of information to get across. So maybe just one thing, all right? Let's quickly rewatch that, because that was a lot.
Of energy that can be transported, a photon. An elementary particle without a real size that can't be split.
Without a real size. So I'm not just going to say one thing, because I'm sure there's going to be a lot of crazy things in the rest of this video, right? But what are you saying there, without any real size? Like, what the hell does that mean? Well, thanks to something called, like, conformal squashing, right? They are basically sizeless. Kind of is the same as being, like, infinitely large. You know, infinitely small. Our poor little monkey brains can't comprehend it. Just to understand as well what it really is... People like to call these things point particles with, you know, infinitesimal size, so it doesn't have a size. But really, it's an excitation in a quantum field. What the hell does that mean? Well, I'm sorry, you're probably going to have to go look at, buy a quantum field textbook and try and understand what a quantum field is, because there's no real way to do that with English words. There's no analog I can say to explain what a quantum field is. It's not like a normal field. It's not like some waves on the beach. We like to lie and say it is, but it's not.
It only created or destroyed. Light also has a wave-particle duality, being kind of a particle and a wave at the same time, although this is
wrong. So this is old quantum mechanics. We've gone beyond this. We've now at the territory of quantum field theory, where you only have quantum fields. So the whole being a wave and a particle at the same time is before we understood... Before we had quantum field theory. And so the field interpretation of this stuff is it's always fields. And the field is way more analogous with a little wave. It's always waves, okay? But these waves are not the waves you're thinking of. It's very abstract. And the particle thing, that comes into play when you try to make measurements of things. Because, you know, you can... basically collapse a cloud of probabilities, right? And then it becomes in a one well-defined area generally. But that well-defined area, the particle can still be around in that area, right? It's still not a particle. You essentially have this field coalesced into a smaller area. Stuff is just math. And, you know, we're trying to do physics here. We're trying to understand how the universe works. And that's probably pretty hard if you just have abstract mathematics in your mind the whole time. It can be done, and you can get predictions, but there's lots of examples of this stuff in physics where we don't understand, and people aren't even sure if it's a real thing, like the wave function, or virtual particles, and things like this.
Is a lie. Also, when we say light, we actually mean...
So we said a lie. That's good. So
light, we actually mean end of a particle and a wave at the same time, although this is a lie. Also, when we say light, we actually mean visible light, which is a tiny part of the electromagnetic spectrum, energy in form of electromagnetic radiation. Electromagnetic radiation consists of an enormous range of wavelengths and frequencies. Gamma rays have the smallest wavelengths because they're the highest energy photons. But most gamma rays are just under 10 picometers, which is still way smaller than a hydrogen atom. For reference, a hydrogen atom compared to a cent is about as big as a cent compared to the moon. Visible light is in the middle of the spectrum, in the range of about 400 nanometers to 700 nanometers, about the size of bacteria.
And all the colors you see are not there in nature. The colors are invented in our brain, and it's just like a segment, it's like an interval of that range that we can see, from 400 to 700 to 800 nanometers. There's little intervals, our brain goes, okay, this little interval, we're going to code that for this thing you see in your head. The color in nature is not really there.
It's about the size of bacteria. On the other end of the spectrum, radio waves can be up to 100 kilometers in diameter, while the biggest wavelengths we know exist can span from 10,000 kilometers to a baffling 100,000 kilometers.
Our galaxy is 100,000 light years across. And I don't think this is, they're actually, they can get bigger, right? We're kind of worried there could be, you know, gravitational waves that could be way longer, right? And so we can't really gauge how big the universe is because some of these wavelengths might be too long. There's all kinds of things like this.
Way larger than Earth. From a physics standpoint, all these different waves are the same. They all have the wave-particle duality and travel at c, the speed of light, just at different frequencies. So what makes visible light special then? Well, absolutely nothing. We just happen to have evolved eyes that are good at registering exactly this part of the electromagnetic spectrum. This is not a complete coincidence, though. Visible light is the only set of electromagnetic radiation that propagates well in water, which happens to be where most eyes first evolved millions of years ago. That
there's an interesting question. How did you come up with the name for Cal? So have you ever seen 2001 A Space Odyssey? HAL 9000? So that's right. And it stands for quantum algorithms. And so if you haven't heard, I'm creating this post-quantum VPN, a brand new type of VPN, and it can protect you from quantum computers, actually. That's going to be important. If you've been seeing the news, IBM 433 qubit device, they're coming, a million qubits, and the internet is going to be absolutely broken unless we start, you know, incorporating this sort of stuff into everything. And this is one way you can protect yourself from retroactive hacking, capture now, decrypt later, and all kinds of things. So come get it. You'd support me in the YouTube.
Was a smart move because light not only interacts with matter, it's also altered by it and can be used to gather information about the world around us with almost no delay, which is arguably really helpful for survival. Okay, where does light come from? A vast range of electromagnetic waves are created when atoms or molecules drop from a higher state of energy to a lower one. They lose energy and emit it in the form of radiation. At the microscopic level, visible light...
If you have a photon of light hit this probability cloud and it has the exact right energy to get to this next energy level up here where you'd see an orbital like that, well then this atom will absorb the photon, jump up, right? And then at some arbitrary time in the future, it'll jump back down the energy level and then it will actually release the photon in any direction, and a random direction, and at an arbitrary time. That is responsible for a lot of things in nature. To even describe this stuff is sort of somewhat still beyond us. It's like we don't understand, you know, some of this at a fundamental level, and the absorption and just re-emission, it's really bizarre stuff to think about.
Are created when atoms or molecules drop from a higher state of energy to a lower one. They lose energy and emit it in the form of radiation. At the microscopic level, visible light is created when an electron within an atom, that is, in an excited state, drops to a lower energy state and loses this excess energy. The same way incoming light can elevate an electron to a higher state of energy by being absorbed by it. Macroscopically, the moving charge of the electron creates an oscillating magnet field, which creates an oscillating electric field perpendicular to it. These two fields move themselves through space, transferring energy from one place to another, carrying information about its place of creation with it. Why, of all the things in the universe, is light the fastest thing there is? Let's change the question.
So again, there's so much here. So that's because it's the speed of causality, right? And to break the speed of causality, things start happening in reverse, essentially. You get cause and effect being reversed, and that doesn't make a lot of sense, does it? You've probably heard how photons for light, it's here and anywhere instantaneously, doesn't experience time, it doesn't have any size, as you've heard, so it also doesn't experience distance. And so as you approach the speed of light, all of those things start to sort of manifest. So like distance shrinks, time slows down, and if you were to get to that, it would stop, but you can't because it would take an infinite energy for anything with mass.
In the universe, is light the fastest thing there is? Let's change the question. What is the fastest...
Through space-time, that is, okay. So like, if there's some way out of space-time, maybe that anything goes, but then you're outside of time, and it's like, what does that even mean?
Way to travel through space in the universe. It's c, exactly 299,792,458 meters per second in a vacuum, 1 billion kilometers per hour. Electromagnetic radiation just happens to move this fast. Any particle that has no mass travels at c, without acceleration or any in between. The light that's being released from a candle does not speed up until it reaches light speed. At the very instant of its creation, its speed is c. So why is c, or the speed of light, finite then? Well, nobody knows. Our universe is just built this way. We don't have a smart answer here. So light is a part of a spectrum, an elementary particle that also behaves like a wave, propelled by two perpendicular fields traveling at the speed limit of the universe. Okay, that's nice and all, but what about all the crazy stuff about traveling at the speed of light and time, the twin paradox, quantum stuff, and things like that? We have to save them for another video. For now, let's just be happy that we evolved eyes that pick up waves of information permeating the universe, making us see things that help us to put our existence into perspective.
So you might say he hasn't talked about so much to do with light here, and I would agree, but I think his little summary here is actually quite nice, because he's just talking about, like, we can see this stuff, and it's actually way more mysterious than the stuff we see, but it also is responsible for the world working. So rather than going into the deep physics of it all, which just sort of breaks any understanding you had of nature, I think this is a good way to do it. It's a very good intro video into, like, light is not what we think, right? Just to give you a glimpse, if you're interested in this stuff, you should definitely go into physics and help out, because, like, if humans survive, it's going to be many, many, many moons before we get any closer to what it really is going on. And that's awesome, you know? It means you still got stuff to do, and don't feel like, you know, everything's already done, all the businesses have already been made. You know, what more can we do? I used to feel like that when I was younger, but there's still so much in physics that we know is not all there is. Dark energy, dark matter, like, there's stuff to do and things to be done. So if you feel like that, come study physics. But anyway, that would be enough for that video.